I successfully executed the biggest heist in Minecraft hacking history, and I'm ready to tell the story. This vault contains no treasure, but it allowed me to steal from those that stole from me. Before I can tell you about the vault and my clever heist, let me tell you about what made me do it. In a previous Minecraft Hacked episode, I told you about the Reach Hack. It's a hack to hit players and mobs from very far away. You can basically fly around and just snipe them. And I really wanted to figure out how it works, so I spent a lot of time thinking about it and eventually I figured it out. Kinda. The idea is a magic trick. The look is a bit deceiving. You're not actually hitting somebody from far away. In reality, you send lots of movement packets in a single tick. Basically, you move to the target, hit it, and move back. And the moves are basically small teleports. It's the maximum distance per movement packet you are allowed to move. Here is a small test setup. One of my very first hacks in my own mod was a teleport one. It's super simple, simply move your player position forward a specific amount. And it works well, but you cannot teleport through a wall. So how is it possible that the person can hit somebody through all these walls? I stared at the code for a long time, but I just couldn't figure it out. So I decided to put on my mask and build the vault. The vault is a huge bedrock cube with a small room inside. First you have to press a button on the outside and then quickly press a button on the inside. So if you can teleport inside this cube, then the arbitrary reach hack is trivial. Teleport through any walls, hit somebody, teleport back out. And it didn't take long for the first people to arrive. Maybe if we watch them, we can figure out how they did it. They press the button and moments later they are inside. Oh, did you see what happened here? They did not teleport straight from the button to the inside. If we slow down the footage, we can see that they first teleport up and moments later teleport down. This makes so much sense, because already in the very first episodes of this whole series, we figured out that while teleporting through walls doesn't work, teleporting through roofs does work. Here's another test setup. We have increasingly thick ceilings and starting easy with short heights, we have no problem teleporting through those layers. So is this how it was done? I guess I overcomplicated everything again. Instead of teleporting in a line, you basically teleport up into the sky, go towards the target and teleport down. This way you seem to be able to go anywhere. Is this how the arbitrary reach hack works? Well, turns out, not quite. When I try to vertically teleport into the vault, it doesn't work. I mean, obviously a part of it is to teleport up and down, but it's not that simple. There must be more. Going back to our experiments, we can see when this happens. Starting with a height of 11, we cannot teleport up anymore. And the vault has very thick walls, around 50 blocks, so there must be another trick. Let's investigate. I have pulled and set up the paper server code like I've used in the previous videos, so we can browse the Minecraft server source and print information we need. So, how do we go about this? If you want to bypass anything, it's generally good to start with the condition that fails. In our case, it's the teleport through thick ceilings. When we run our local test server and attempt it, we can see in the logs the error message. The server rejected our movement attempt because we moved too quickly. With this message, we can now find the interesting part in the code. Simply searching for it and here it is. And no surprise, this code is in the server game packet listener in the handle move player function. So this function is executed when a player sends a movement packet to the server. And we apparently got into this if case, which told us the movement was bad and the player was teleported back. And this is a good start to find the bypass. Basically, we now have to look at all the conditions that led here and try to figure out ways how we can avoid them. Basically, how can we avoid these if conditions to become true? And if you watched the recent video about the arbitrary velocity exploit, talking about Bobomb, this code will look familiar. D10 is the player delta movement, so the current player velocity, and D11 is how far the player moved between the last known position and the new position we sent in the movement packet. The velocity gets subtracted from that, and then we go into this if case if the result is larger than this value here. Which means if we get large velocities, we can move longer distances. If we could get delta movement to be a huge number, we could basically teleport anywhere in the world. So, to breach the vault, do we need an arbitrary velocity exploit? To be honest with you, I stared at this movement code for a long time already. I cannot figure this out. My brain just doesn't see it. So, what did I do? Well, here is the real reason for the vault. I'm the owner of the server. I can do whatever I want. People think this is anarchy. Well, it's dictatorship. I control and surveillance everything. So I implemented a packet logger. At the cube, when any of the filthy thieves hit the button on the outside, we start logging. And now every time when we receive a packet from this player, we add it to a list. And when they hit the button on the inside, I stop the logging, which then creates a new packet log file where it just dumps all the packets received in text format. And here is how such a log looks like. The current timestamp in milliseconds, the packet name, for example a position packet, followed by all the values contained in the packet. In the case of the position packet, it's the player position. But you can see all sorts of other packets, like looking around, using an item or doing an arm animation. Anything. Now, before you get mad at me for spying on everyone, to be fair, I said I would do it. When you access the vault, I told you, if you try to steal my secrets, I will steal and expose yours. I'm serious, you have been warned. So it's all your fault that this hack is now getting exposed. You couldn't resist and broke into my vault, and now I steal your hacks. So let's have a look at the successful break-in. Let's see if we can figure this out. Alright, we have some position packets, but their coordinates are not changing. Just fix position at Y level 124, and then boom, suddenly at Y178. This player successfully teleported 54 blocks upwards. How? So what exactly happened here? How can somebody just teleport upwards from 124 to 178? We tried that, it didn't work. Pause the video and have a look at this. Do you notice what is special here? What is the trick? I give you a moment. Do you see it? Last chance. Look here at the timing. These position packets were received within 1 millisecond. 1 millisecond. This is not a coincidence. When you stand still, Minecraft sends like one position packet every second. So one packet every 1000 milliseconds. So sending multiple packets per 1 millisecond, this was done on purpose. I guess let's just try this. Here's my hack, and I extend my teleport code now. I just use the packet helper function I implemented for the reach hack, which allows me to send packets immediately. And so apparently we just have to create a loop to send a couple of position packets off the current player position, and then at the end we send the actual teleport packet to the target location. This is of course all done immediately within a few milliseconds. Let's go back into the game and see if it works. Let's check out the ceiling test again, set the teleport distance, and go. Damn, it worked. Why does this work? If you just try to change your position, it fails. But if you spam your current position a few times and then send the teleport one, it works. What? Let's investigate. We have the local server setup. First of all, we can see that we do not get the message about moving too quickly. So this is bypassing this movement check. How? Let's add some logging output to see what is happening here. I simply print D11, so the distance between the old and the new position, and D10, which is the player velocity, and this other value here. When we just stand around now, we don't move at all, so no difference in movement. But we have a small delta movement, that's a velocity, which makes sense, that's gravity pulling us down. Subtract those two, and clearly they are not over 100, so we don't go into this if case. But now let's see what happens if we use the new teleport hack. Select a large distance, like maybe 40, and teleport. And wow, this is not what I expected. Do you see that? First we are spamming the packet with the non-changing position, which makes sense. We have no movement here, but this other value here is suddenly increasing. rapidly, 400, 900, 1600, going to 6400, and then we sent the packet moving far away. And now we have a huge movement. We moved a square distance of 1600, that's 40 blocks, and obviously this is larger than the usual 100, so under normal circumstances this check would fail. But here somehow this value increased, and now 1600 is not larger than 8100. So the movement is okay, the teleport is allowed, we teleported. So why did this value suddenly increase? How did I never notice this? Let's see, we select the maximum value between F2 and this term. And F2 looks constant, it's either 100 or 300, depending on if the player is falling or not. Alright, so this cannot be it. The other term is a calculation though, it's squaring a configured number times I times speed. Obviously we cannot control the spigot config, but maybe we control I or speed. So let's add another debug log to print F2, I and speed. We go back into the game, and when walking around you can see that F2 is a constant 100, I is 1 and speed is also 1. Now let's do the teleport to see what happens. Pay attention to the log. We teleport, and there it is. Look, the I value is incrementing with every movement packet. So here lies the secret. Somehow we control I. So what does I represent? Again, error messages can help us. Here I is compared to the allowed player ticks value, and if it's too large we get the error that the player is sending too many movement packets. And just above it we can see how I is calculated. It's received movement packet count minus known movement packet count. And movement packet count is incremented every time we receive a movement packet. And the other term is set in the tick method, where it's set to the received movement packet count. So it seems that I represents the amount of movement packets received during the current tick. And this number is then used in this calculation, which causes the term to become large enough to allow for large distance teleportation. I really should have looked at this other term. We looked together at the term here, D10 and D11, and thought about exploiting it. But of course there are more variables part of this equation, and if we had explored the other term, we could have maybe figured it out ourselves. So this is a super important moment for reflection to me. I really like to experience failure like this. I failed to find this teleport hack even though I looked at this code for many hours. So why did I miss it? This self-reflection and acceptance of failure is really important for me. First of all, it makes me not complacent with my abilities, always trying to get better. And second, I can analyze what did I do wrong and do it better next time. I think it's clear that I don't lack the coding skills. I can read this Java code and understand it. So the problem is not a technical skill issue. But then what was it? Well, it's a bit hard to know for sure what I did wrong, it was a while ago, but clearly there is no objective good reason to not look at this term more in depth. So I think what happened here is that I was lazy. I guess this term just looked annoyingly long. It's just counting the movement packets. I probably ignored it because I assumed the code would be fine. Whatever it was, I failed to recognize the importance of this line and didn't give it the attention it deserved. This line of code, this check, is probably one of the most important code lines in all of Minecraft. It is part of the code that checks whether to allow a player to teleport large distances or not. Yeah, I failed. But that's fine, because on the next problem I tackle, I will have a lot more experience and skill. What a journey this whole Minecraft series was. To be honest with you, I'm not addicted anymore. Maybe there will be another episode or so, but no promises. I want to work on some other stuff again, but I wanted to say I love doing this Minecraft stuff, and I'm sure once in a while I will check in and see what's going on. The server will stay on for now, of course, so no worries, but don't expect new features. Now speaking of the server, I haven't really explored spawn in a while, so much has changed here. I remember it looking quite grief, but it kinda looks cleaned up. Somebody really put in some work here, damn. But what is even more funny is my original base. This area is just like deleted. It looks like the chunks got reset, only the Herobrine bedrock house remains. Do you remember when I stood here for one episode? Damn, so much happened. Anyway, my deepest thanks and appreciation to everybody who engaged and was involved in this series. It was an honor to play and hack with you all. It made me very happy. Don't worry though, this is not quite the end of it, but I just want to give you all a heads up. This project will slowly fade out. Oh, and by the way, I have merch now, digital merch, and it's even more useful than NFTs. It's a shitty font based on my handwriting. You can purchase it and create a basic resource pack to add it into your game. It's super ugly looking, but hey, it's an elite hacker font. What more do you want? Anyway, check out shoplifeoverflow.com. And now the community showcase. First is Yorian, just showing off their solution of the vault. They have a /vault command executed, boom, they got it, solved. And then we have Enderkill solving it. Look here, I'm standing next to him and look at the chat, just solved it. I didn't even see him flinch. The implementation is so optimized to be done within a single tick, so no other user gets even notified of the position change. It looks pretty crazy, like in an anime, moving so fast nobody sees them. Also here at the Club Mate Challenge, solving it so fast that they are just standing here spewing out mate bottles. It's crazy, within a tick or so, teleport to the chest, open it, stand here and drop the item and do it again. Looks like somebody at CCC having had too many chunks and is now leaning over a sink. And lastly, we have Shrek and T with Enderkill showing off an unintended solution to the vault challenge. So they will first show that they do it and then share a few words on how it worked. It's pretty cool.
Alright, so I just damage myself until I'm low.
Yeah, that's perfectly low, I guess.
Then I can press the button on the inside. Perfect.
Nice.
Yay.
Just 1 sec, a bed setup, I guess. Like, yeah, respawns at the boat location and it just surges the next spot up, which will just be like here. I guess you respawn right here. Like something around here.